Thank you very much. So we're going to be doing a double act, which is probably good news for you. If you had to listen to just one of us for 90 minutes, you'd probably feel a little bit tired. Now, we are going to be arguing that these are very, very dangerous times in marketing. They're very dangerous times in marketing because a lot of what we have been told, a lot of the learning that we have been sold in recent years, is actually destroying effectiveness in many important and damaging ways at the moment. So this is going to be evidence-based. We're going to give you a lot of data. We're going to be chucking a lot of data at you, which is a very cruel thing to do after lunch. It's mostly a general piece. We're going to be talking generally about what drives effectiveness. But we're going to zero in on the issue of print effectiveness at various points during the presentation, because clearly that's the theme of this particular event. But print is, again, one of those unfashionable areas of advertising and marketing that in modern era has, in many areas, kind of almost been written off. But in fact, it has really quite a strong effect in this story to tell. So as part of our contrarian act here, we're going to be reminding you of why print advertising still has a powerful role in effectiveness. So that is our piece. Let me take you a little bit through the data we're going to be using. As you know already, we are going to be using data principally but not exclusively from these two reports. So the long and the short of it, we wrote in 2011, it was published in 2013, but it's the first time that we identified what will be a recurring theme during our presentation, which is that you cannot generalize about effectiveness over all timescales. What works best in the short term is not just different from what works best in the long term, but in many ways is the precise opposite, which is a very, very dangerous fact of life. So we wrote that in 2013. Hardly had the ink dried on that report than people, particularly from a digital persuasion, shall we say, started to say, yes, but the world is changing. The digital revolution has fundamentally changed the laws of marketing, and that stuff, you know, it's so old-fashioned. So last year, we came back with Media in Focus, which was an attempt to look at how things really were changing in the digital era. And of course, there are some changes, but nowhere near as radical as people would have you suggest. We particularly looked at the most recent case studies in there, but we were only concerned with digital era case studies. Now, the data we're using, as always, is the confidential data that's submitted alongside entries to the IPA Effectiveness Awards, which runs every 2 years in the UK. It's our version of the Effies, if you like. And it enables us very simply to examine how inputs, in the sense of, say, strategic or media choices, influence outcomes in the sense of hard business effectiveness. And we use hard business metrics. So it's evidence-based. It's based on, as you can see there, more than 500 case studies purely from the digital era. And we're really going to mine those today. Now, we're going to delve into a new report, which isn't actually published yet. It's going to be out next month. If we were to take you through all of our findings, Les and I would be found hanging from Tower Bridge sometime next week. But we are going to indiscreetly share some of the findings with you. So I'm afraid we're going to have to shut the doors at the end and kill you all. But anyway, that's another matter. But this new publication is about how we have to flex the rules slightly, depending on the context that our brand is, whether it's online or offline, new or old, packaged goods or services or durables, and so on. The rules are slightly shifted. So that's what this new book is about. It's going to be a kind of manual for how to get it right for your particular brand, your particular sector. So there'll be a little bit of that in there as well. Again, it's based on the same kind of data. So we're going to look at five areas. I'll take the first of those. Les is going to take most of the rest. I'll leave him to do the hard work, and then we'll come back at the end and talk a little bit about, you know, where things have been going wrong and how we can put them right. So we're going to talk about the need to balance brand building, which we do for long-term growth, with sales activation, which we do for short-term sales right now. We talked in 2013, along the short of it, about the 60-40 rule. 60% brand building, 40% sales activation is the sweet spot. We'll revisit that. We're going to talk about maximizing reach. Again, this is an area where in recent years many people have told us reach no longer matters. We'll come back and argue very strongly in favour of that. We're going to be using a mental construct from Byron Sharp and the Ehrenberg Bass Institute, which is around mental availability, to again talk about how different creative approaches work. We're also going to talk about the vital issue of budgeting and budgeting for growth. A lot of people have been deluded in recent years into thinking that somehow the number of krona we put behind our campaigns really doesn't matter anymore. It's all about how cleverly we can target. And we're fundamentally going to have a go at that, because that turns out to be what we would call in English tosh. I'm sure you have your own rude words in Swedish to describe it. And I invite you to think about them as we come to that. And then we're going to talk a bit about using the right media for the right jobs, and we'll obviously touch on press there again, because again, there are some very interesting characteristics of print advertising that we will highlight at that point. So those are our five things. When we get to number five, you'll know it'll be nearly time for a break, and you'll no doubt be quite pleased. So let's take the first of those then, which is about balancing brand and activation, which we coined as the 60-40 rule, which seems to have acquired some notoriety around the world, thank goodness. So I'm just going to nail exactly what we mean about brand building and sales activation, because I think what we've realized over the years is that those terms get reinterpreted in various areas. So we want to be quite clear about what we mean. So let's first of all start with what we mean by activation. And some of this is very obvious, but some of it you may possibly disagree with us. But I'll give you the evidence as to why we are piling this into the activation area. So short-term sales activation. Now, there's some very, very obvious examples of this. So all of those price ads that we see, the Aldi one, this is an Australian ad for an Australian electronics retailer. We know that. I don't think anyone would argue that that is sales activation. And, of course, the digital equivalents of that, the serving of timely and relevant offers to people, you know, when their data trail suggests that they're about to buy. All of that is activation, whether it's digital or analog, no doubt about it. Price, deals, and messages are all around that. But there is another school of activation which is also very powerful, which we might call the occasion prompt. So this is a classic example of that. It's a small poster site outside an Asda supermarket in the UK, just reminding people as they're going in that this particular product, which is a potato product, is actually quite a handy solution if you're wondering what you're going to buy the kids for supper tonight. So all of that, and of course there is a digital equivalent of that. We know increasingly we know where people are, and we can serve those kind of messages digitally to them. But again, this is all about prompting, nudging behavior at the last moment, at the moment of consumption. These ads speak to people who are about to buy, already know they want the product, already have some interest in the purchase. And they either will or will not work there and then. If the deal is good, if the message is relevant, they may well have quite a powerful effect. But it happens in the short term. It's not intended and will never be memorable. You know, I would challenge any of you to remember any of those ads on that I've shown you so far. Yeah, how can we remember them? But they will create a short-term impression. Now, I want to bring in this. I'm not going to play you the ad because I don't want any of you to start leaving the audience so soon. This is an ad for Garnier Ultra Lift. So it's an anti-wrinkle cream product. And Les and I, we're kind of getting a bit older now, so we're starting to get more interested in these kinds of products. So this is an ad, obviously, that targets people who are interested in anti-aging products. But it is full of science and information and facts. And like I say, I don't want to lose you this early on in the presentation, so I'm not going to play it to you. But I'm going to show you the kind of sales response you get from those functional, rational, what the Americans would call reason why ads. They give us a technical story. This one is quite technical too, and it has this thing called the wrinkle reader that we're supposed to hold up to our faces and ascertain just how bad our wrinkling is. Scary thought. I'm definitely not going to do that. It's far too scary. Even looking in the mirror is scary for me. So, but that works in all of these ads work in a very, very different way. If we know and we're interested in the market, they will nudge us to try that product. They are not about creating enduring memory structures that will mean that in 6 or 12 months' time we are more disposed towards those brands. And I'll give you the evidence for that in just a moment. We contrast that with what we call long-term brand building. And when this is done well, this is almost always creating powerful emotional associations with our brands that prime us to want to buy them, and it has to be done well ahead of the point of purchase. So I'll give you some data in a moment from this Procter & Gamble Make-A-Wish campaign called Enduring Care, which again was about creating emotional associations around a small group of brands associated with a brand purpose, which was about helping sick young kids, you know, enjoy the life that they have. So really emotive, powerful issue, associating those brands with that, it creates a powerful set of emotional associations intended to predispose people to want to buy that brand. But these kinds of emotional messages, we don't forget them overnight. If the hairs have been standing up on the back of our neck, or we've shed a little tear as a result of an ad, we are not going to forget that tomorrow. We're not going to forget it next month. We're not going to forget it next quarter. We're going to remember these for a long time. And they keep working for a very long time. This fantastic Snickers campaign, again, built on a great emotional insight that, you know, when we get hungry, you know what, we get a bit grumpy, we lose it a bit, you know, we fall apart. It's a lovely emotional insight. There's no product innovation, there's no product message in that campaign, and it has driven consistent global growth for that brand for a number of years. The fantastic Lifebuoy online video campaign. This is the most powerful piece of emotional video you will ever see. If you don't already know it, go and search it. Search it out, Lifebuoy. It is, I defy any of you not to shed a tear when you've seen it. It's Unilever. Procter & Gamble, Unilever, Mars. Three of the biggest, you know, brand owners on the planet. They're all doing this. They've learnt the lesson that emotional brand building works and works in the long term. And I would add to that a Clorox, a US company that have absolutely followed and quote Les and I regularly as being, you know, a guiding principle for how they've transformed their business. Again, what comes next is everything. This is for a cleansing wipe intended for kitchens. It's a very saucy ad, you know, it's got definite Scandinavian overtones too. Anyway, so there is very, very different. These work to prime people, and they work over the long term, and they work in very different ways. So let's not kid ourselves that when we do information advertising of the sort of the Garnier Ultra lift, that we're actually building brands, because we're very, very weakly building brands. These are the kinds of campaigns that do it. So let me give you some evidence. This is a chart from the Garnier Ultra lift case study. This is classically what we get when we do activation advertising, whether it's deals or prompts or rational reason why advertising. You can see the issue here. While the ads were on air, there was a significant uplift to sales. Of course, it was prompting people, nudging them to go out and buy. But in this case, in each case, within about 4 or 5 weeks of the end of that advertising burst, essentially base sales returned to trend. There was no real turning around of the progress of that brand. So any effects we measure, any paybacks we calculate, are all within, essentially within the window that the advertising was on. It's short term. This has led to a way of thinking which is called always on. You know this? Let's be always on as a brand. Sounds terribly trendy. It's goddamn expensive. Don't go there. We want to be always on mentally, but we don't have to be always on in expenditure terms. If you do the long-term brand building piece, you are always on mentally. It's mental availability. But that is a really expensive way of doing it. Very expensive, as they know. But contrast that, if you will, with an equivalent sales response curve to the Fairy Enduring Care. Now, it's not a perfect experiment, because sadly for us, they didn't completely stop advertising in the 18-month period between those two major bursts of this enduring care emotional work. But you can see there that it takes a long time before the campaign finished, before the sales start to level and then gently trending down. And you can see there as well that they built, this is for Fairy, they took their brand leadership position from just around about 50% to over 60%. That's an incredible achievement. This is real brand dominance. And they never had achieved that through classic product benefit, product focused advertising. It was the emotional stuff that helped take them over that final growth line. So Procter & Gamble are big advocates now of emotional advertising, as I'm sure you know, and we'll come back and touch on them as we go through. So we have to remember that there are two ways marketing works, as you know, and I'll reprise a chart that we first published in The Long and the Short of It. My apologies to those who've seen this so many times that you're bored to tears with it and don't want to see it again, but we just keep throwing it at you. So we have to remember there are two ways that we can drive sales uplift over base. and they work in different timescales. So the way that works most powerfully in the long term, as I've argued, is brand building. So that's the creation of these emotional associations, these priming associations that make us over time want to buy the brand more and more. They make it an easy choice for us. Now, they need to be very broadly targeted to all category buyers because they're going to work long ahead of the moment of purchase. We're talking here to people who don't know us, probably don't like us, certainly don't think of us. So we've got to reach them early, and we've got to create the kind of advertising that they're still going to take on board. That's why emotions are so important. But that's what drives long-term sales growth. Now, you can see that the steps in this growth ladder are relatively modest. We don't drive huge shifts each time we do it. It takes a long time to build a brand, as you know. But the point about this kind of advertising is the decay rates are very slow. So we build cumulatively year on year. So if you like, next year's sales targets get easier to achieve than this year's sales targets were, because we're priming people to want to buy us even before they know it. The trouble is that so much attention has been driven in recent times by the sales activation model of thinking, because digital does it quite well, does it very well, in fact, in many ways. But this is where all the thinking and money and effort is increasingly going. So these are, as I argued before, these prompts, behavioral prompts that nudge us to do something now. Now, they need to be very tightly targeted, ideally as close to the moment of consumption as possible, because no one's going to remember them. So we need to serve them in a timely and relevant manner. But they really only build short-term sales uplifts. Now, if you've got a big deal, an interesting piece of new product news, or some nice behavioral nudge, you can get quite big sales uplifts. But the decay rates of these kinds of ads are very rapid, either because they are just unmemorable, which I've argued already, or because they're often time-limited in their very nature. Could be a seasonal thing as well. So they decay very rapidly. So you can see that you very rapidly plateau. And if you like, what you're not driving is long-term year-on-year growth with that. But you are having some fantastic short-term spikes. And they're very observable, and they're probably very measurable, and they probably give the CFO a very warm feeling in his pocket. But they are not driving long-term growth, and that's the big problem. So you can see the essential danger we have here. If you measure success in the long term, that is to say the right-hand side of that chart, you will correctly come to the conclusion that brand building is the most powerful way of driving growth. But if you measure success in the short term, that is to say the left-hand side of that chart, you will also correctly come to the conclusion that the sales activation approach is the most powerful way of driving growth. Because in the short term, it is. There's no doubt about it. And just to add, as we say in English, insult to injury, there's an additional problem, which is that the cusp point, the point at which brand building starts to take over as the dominant driver of growth, is around about 6 months into the life of a campaign, assuming the campaign even runs that long. And so many campaigns these days are being developed that don't even run for a quarter, let alone 6 months. So you're never, ever, that is your thinking and that's the kinds of campaigns you put into the marketplace, you're never going to measure long-term benefits, and you're always going to be driven to a short-term sales activation kind of model. But let me just remind us why brand building is still alive and well and vital. And it's quite simple here. If we divide our 500 case studies into four piles, we've got the Dunce's Corner on the left-hand side that did very little for the brand and frankly weren't very good at activating. We've got those that added powerful activation effects, but you know what, weren't really interested in building the brand. And this is increasingly a big group of campaigns. This is what new thinking is teaching people to do. Then we've got those that, in perhaps a slightly old-fashioned way, focused very much on building the brand but didn't do very much to activate short-term sales. And then on the right-hand side, we've got the ones that did what Les and I have been arguing for the last 6 or 7 years or so, is what you should be doing, which is to build the brand and then activate the hell out of your growing sense of enthusiasm for it. Let's look at how that played out in terms of our business effectiveness metric. Well, two things to learn from this chart. Firstly, you have to be doing both. If you really want to be super effective, you need to build the brand and activate the hell out of it, as Les and I have been on. You'd expect us to say that. But just notice two things. This is a long-term metric. Building the brand is much more important to long-term growth than activating. We can only get so far, as we argued on the last chart, with simply activating like crazy. We have to build the brand if we really want long-term growth. It's pretty stark when you look at that chart. Brands matter. Anyone who tells you that brands is kind of last millennium thinking are idiots. They really are. This is what drives profitability for business. Brands don't just drive sales, they drive margin. We'll come back to that later on. But there's another thing. A lot of people say, yeah, but brand building, this is all about the long term. You know, we're a very agile business. We live in the short term from day to day, moment to moment. It's just not relevant to us. Idiots, we say. Idiots. If you want to be an agile business that can take advantage of short-term opportunities and respond to immediate threats powerfully, you need to have a powerful brand that you can activate against. If we do nothing to strengthen our brand, you can see that our ability to drive powerful short-term effects is massively weakened. And of course, this is a situation lots and lots of brands find themselves in. They walk away from brand building, they end up with a brand that's really difficult to defend against onslaughts. We argued, therefore, brands have to do both, budgets must balance. We talked about the 60-40 optimum point, and that's still very much the case. But we're going to add to that some new principles here, because the 60-40 rule is alive and well. But what we're going to be observing in our new report, Effectiveness in Context, is that we need to flex that slightly. And when brand building is easy, we should be upweighting activation. Or when activation is difficult, we should be upweighting activation. We're trying to aim for a balanced set of effects. So we have to put money behind the difficult task. That's the opposite of what people do. And we upweight brand when activation is easy. If it's very easy for us to drive short-term effects, it doesn't mean to say we should be putting more money into it. We should be taking that money out and putting it into the brand because we have to achieve balanced effects. Now, of course, the big development in recent years with the growth of digital has been it's got easier to activate. So we ought to be expecting brand building to be getting more important. Come back to that in a minute. So what we find is that essentially where either activation is easy or brand building is more difficult, we need to put more money into brand building. And this is a lot of the context that we look at. So, for instance, high involvement purchases where there's a very rational decision and people think a lot about it, that means more brand building. Online brands, easy to activate, more brand building. The more research that's done online around those brands, the easier it is to activate and the more we should be spending on brand. New and growing categories, big brands generally. We'll go into this in much more detail in a few weeks' time. Or if we have a premium brand, a premium price brand, and we want to defend that price premium, we have to be doing more brand building than for a typical brand. So there are situations where we will flex the rules slightly, but all of that will be coming out in a few weeks' time. So what does this mean? That some categories, some sectors, are more brand should be more brand focused than others. So what we find is that, say, durables and packaged goods are pretty close to the 60-40 sweet spot, but financial services particularly. This is an area where activation is relatively easy, but brand building is quite tough often. What does that mean? It means we should be spending a lot more money on brand building, and the smart case studies are the ones that do that. That is precisely the opposite of what we observe is going on in financial services around the world. These are the lemmings rushing to the cliff edge of overactivation, and we'll make that point later on in the presentation. Okay? There are certain areas of services where actually, you know, we should be upping the activation slightly, but most of the situations we observe, we should be upping the brand. So the inevitable consequence then of activation becoming easier in the digital era is, in fact, if we look at a time trend in this, and there are other factors at play in terms of the changing nature of economies. So it's not only to do with activation getting easier, but we observe a time trend which is towards greater investment in brand building for optimum effectiveness. Exactly the opposite of what is going on out there at the moment, and exactly the opposite of what most people think. But that's what the data is teaching us. So I'm going to end with one example of this, quickly before I hand over to Les, which is the EasyJet case study. Now, EasyJet is the ultimate online brand. It's an airline, an online airline, low-cost airline. You know EasyJet. Competitor to Norwegian, of course, increasingly. Now, these guys, the story kind of starts in 2010, having a tough time post the global financial crisis. Oil prices were high. These guys were losing profitability at an alarming rate. They were having trouble filling their seats, and they were getting caught between aggressive discounters like Ryanair, who are very price-focused, and full-service airlines like, say, British Airways or SAS, who were increasingly reducing their prices and adopting some of the ways of low-cost airlines to bring their pricing down. So these guys found themselves in a bit of a no-man's land between these two issues, squeezed and going nowhere. And they realized that their only way forward was to stop doing what they were doing at the moment, which was just to pour ever more money into short-term activation. They were spending enormous, 35% of their budget was being spent on paid search alone, just buying that last minute of attention, bidding against Ryanair and Norwegian and all the others for that last moment of attention. It is a fool's world. It gets more and more expensive, and you cannot win that battle. So they realized they needed to start building the brand again. And to be brave, they went right the way through the business, found the savings to invest in a brand building campaign. I'll show you the results in a minute. But a big part of this was press. Press was about 30% of their advertising budget. Press for an online brand. Were they crazy? No, they weren't crazy. They were very clever. It was a big part of helping them to turn the business around. They used TV as well, of course. It was a multi-channel campaign. So they had a lovely, very colourful and very visible kind of and well-branded campaign that worked very well in press. They had a go at British Airways with their To Fly to Serve logo. They said To Fly to Save. You know, and they also had a strand of activity which they ran in more business-orientated press, which was about targeting business travellers. Like Les and I, who regularly flying around Europe, but actually just say to them, you know what, this is not a horrible product you're going to be flying with. We can get you there, and you can have a decent... And you know, I regularly use them, and have more or less walked away from full-service airlines ever since. So this was a really important part of the brand job they were trying to do, but of course they wanted to activate as well. And they're trying to sell destinations as well as sell the airline. It's a brand-building job, and you cannot do that with last-minute digital-driven advertising, because you don't know that you want to go to Algarve or the Channel Islands or whatever it is. You just don't know you want to go there. So you can't serve relevant messages to people. You've got to sell them the whole idea of getting there. And this is really important to the learning of EasyJet. So they pulled enormous amounts of money out of paid search in particular, but they did it to fund this, which was a turnaround of their brand metrics. These are the really important achievements of this campaign. They completely turned around the whole brand position. Let's not worry too much about the metrics. You can see which way the charts were going. But I want to just land with one last point, which is the really, really important learning from this campaign in the digital era and for brands that are trying to balance brand and activation. Because these guys radically altered their budget allocation of those periods over that period from a very inefficient budget allocation to a very efficient budget allocation. In their first year, of course, they did spend more because they had a problem to fix, but look at what happened over the time. So in the year before, they spent about £15 million in the UK, more than a third of which was in paid search. Insane. We would never argue that one should spend nothing on paid search, particularly if you're a digital business, but putting 35% of your money into that is insane. And there are plenty of digital businesses who put a lot more, 75% of their budget. They are increasingly realizing the terrible mistake they're making. So over that period of time, they put more in the next year. They tried to remedy this. So they invested some money in year one, positive investment. Some of that money came from pulling money out of search, pulling away from branded search, their own brand search, for instance, is a good example of that. But just notice, by 2013, they transformed the business. Every passenger they flew generated more than six times as much profit for them than they did in 2010. They totally transformed the profitability of this business. They did it on a smaller budget in 2013 than they had used in 2010 because they got the campaign optimized. And that's really what this is really all about in many ways. So I'm going to hand over to Les and leave him.
Okay, so the first principle is basically brand building matters. You've got to lead with brand building. And that's true for every brand, in every category, in every context that we examined. Brand building is the main driver of growth and profit for all businesses and all brands. So that's where you've got to focus the bulk of your attention. So how do you do brand building? Well, brand building surely is about brand loyalty, isn't it? We've got to build a really strong relationship with our customer segment. We've got to really make sure that we have a group of people who love our brand. No, it's not. That is nonsense. Brand loyalty is not the principal driver of strong brands. I think this is an idea that maybe 15 years ago would have been quite fashionable, the idea of pursuing brand loyalty. And what's happened, I think, over that time is firms have begun to realize that loyalty-first strategies do not work. The work of Andrew Ehrenberg and his protégés at Ehrenberg Bass and Byron Sharp and our own research has shown again and again that loyalty-first strategies underperform. If you focus primarily on brand loyalty, you will waste your money and get underwhelming business results. The way brands grow is not through loyalty, it's through penetration primarily. Penetration is the main driver of growth. The way that brands grow is primarily by getting more customers. Loyalty is a secondary effect, a secondary issue, a secondary concern. Now, we've been saying this for over 10 years now. Byron Sharp's been saying it for a very long time. But what you hear people saying all the time is, well, that might be true in FMCG, might be true if you're selling soap, but I'm an airline, or I'm a bank, or I'm some other online business, and in my world, it's different. Loyalty matters. We have a relationship with our customers. We can get really strong brand loyalty. No, you can't. What we find, we've looked at this in different categories, at different stages of the brand life cycle, for brands at different price points and different sizes. There are no examples of brands that grow through loyalty first. Penetration is always the name of the game. So if any of you are out there working on a loyalty first marketing strategy, you need to go home and tear it up. Acquisition, penetration, that's the primary focus of marketing. Loyalty, if you get that right, loyalty generally moves with you, moves along in its wake, as it were. But actually, there's an even smarter strategy, and that's the reach strategy. Talk to everyone. Talk to everyone who buys the category. And I literally mean everyone who buys the category. Don't fret too much about segmentation, not at least in terms of who you want to appeal to. Focus on everyone who's likely to buy the category in the next 2 or 3 years. That's a really broad target. If you're selling cars, you need to talk to some people who may not yet have passed their driving test, because brand building is a long-term project. So reach is the name of the game, and reach actually is the main thing that explains why marketing works. About 90% of variations in media effectiveness are related to the reach of the medium and the campaign. So reach, the number of eyeballs, if you like, is the principal determinant of whether or not your campaign will work. It's a numbers game. Okay, so that's rule two. Make sure you hit a fuck of a lot of people, basically. Secondly, when you've got the numbers, you need to get high share of mind, or as psychologists call it, high mental availability. So psychologists use this concept of mental availability to describe the ease with which something comes to mind and the clarity with which it comes to mind. What our mental image of a thing is. And this is tremendously important for human decision making. We like to think of ourselves as rational thinkers, logical thinkers. Mostly we're not. Mostly we make our judgments and our decisions based on a kind of intuition, what's called system one thinking. And a big influence on our decisions is this idea of mental availability. Does it come to mind? Does it feel right? When you're choosing brands, the same thing applies. The main determinant of whether or not you choose a brand in a given situation is how easily that brand comes to mind and how clearly you think of it. And one can think of it at a number of levels. Base level is brand awareness. We all know about brand awareness. It's important. It's important that people know your brand, because people do not like unfamiliar brands. They feel much more comfortable with the brands that they know and love. It's a human trait. Human beings are interested in unfamiliar things, they pay attention to unfamiliar things, and they do not like them. They like the things that they are familiar with and that they actually pay less attention to. So first base, make sure people know your brand, make sure your brand is familiar. That means that people are more likely to accept your brand if you sell it to them. But passively accepting the brand is a weak situation to be in. What you want is to be actively sought after. And to get to that level, your brand has got to be in their heads all the time. Your brand has got to come to mind whenever they think of the product category. So if it's an airline, as soon as I think about flying somewhere, I've got to think of EasyJet. You know, it's got to be one of the first brands that comes to mind. Salience. Spontaneous awareness, if you like. And spontaneous awareness in every single buying situation, every single relevant situation. If you're McDonald's, clearly you want to be the first brand that people think of when they want a burger, but you also want to be the first brand that people think of when they want a coffee, or when they want breakfast, or when they want a treat for their kids, or whatever. You need to be high salience in all relevant contexts. And then if you're really lucky, you can get to the top level of fame. You want to be a brand that is so salient, so much in people's heads, that it's in the culture. It's a brand that people talk about, that people reference. The kind of brands that stand-up comedians make jokes about, because everyone knows what you're talking about. And when you get to that level, you actually turn the people, the culture, the media into an arm of your sales force. As a result, what you find is as you go up the scale of mental availability, you get increasing returns. So you get disproportionately large effects for brands that actually become famous and that create fame through marketing. We find that campaigns that achieve fame work four times harder in terms of converting budget into sales and produce by far the biggest profit gains. So fame is tremendously powerful in marketing. How do you get that? Well, if you're doing sales activation, the short-term selling job, then it's pretty much straightforward, rational persuasion. What we find is that the more you move from emotional appeals to purely rational messaging, the bigger the short-term activation effects. If you want to convert someone at the point of sale online, give them a price offer or give them some little rational nugget that will persuade them that this is the brand for them. But brand building works quite differently. For brand building, the more you move away from telling people things to making people feel things, the stronger the brand effects, the bigger the long-term growth, the bigger the long-term profit. And brand building, as I said, is the main driver of growth and profit. So emotion is the main driver of growth and profit for businesses. Messaging plays a relatively small role. And emotion is tremendously important if you want fame, because people don't talk and care about things that they don't feel something about. So if you want fame, you want emotion at scale. You want great emotive creative work, and you need to do it at the sort of level and scale with the number of eyeballs that will kind of get a mass movement going. Now, that requires great creative work. Creativity is not a luxury. Creativity is the kind of thing that creates an emotional response. You get much more of an emotional response from a lovely story about an animated penguin than you do from a little piece of programmatic with a price offer. Emotion is tremendously important, and great creative work produces much stronger emotional responses. So we find that ads that win creative awards tend to produce stronger emotional responses than ordinary advertising. Also, ads that win creative awards are much more likely to become famous. You do something creative and interesting and emotional, then you're likely to get people talking, which is why the ads that win creative awards tend to be highly efficient in converting advertising spend into sales, about 10 or 11 times more efficient than ordinary advertising. So creativity really does work. So great creative work, that's one of the keys to producing a strong brand response and one of the keys to getting your brand to be famous. But it's not enough, because you need creativity and emotion at scale. And scale, unfortunately, requires budget. So I think if we went back maybe 10 years ago, it would be fair to say that marketers were beginning to think you could do all this for free. You know, you could just go viral. You could just put a little video out there and it would somehow take off. And through earned media or viral sharing or whatever, you know, we could do the marketing job on zero budget. Now, perhaps in the early days, that was a little bit easier. But these days, the internet is so clogged with, you know, funny videos and clever little bits of viral marketing, it's very, very hard. For every Gangnam Style that creates, you know, and I use an old reference because that's probably about the last really big one, for every one of those, there is some little funny ad for soap that's seen by, you know, a million people. That's fantastic. A million people is a small number in marketing. You need tens and hundreds of millions to move the dial. So what we find is that paid media are still vital, even if you want that online sharing. We find that the amount of earned media that you get from your marketing campaign, the amount of sharing, the amount of online views, the amount of buzz in social media is closely related to the budget. If you try to generate earned media, there is only one combination that works reliably, and it's that one. You need to have some great owned content, and then you need to have a shed load of paid media to promote it, to get it in front of people, to get people talking about it, to get people to watch it, and then you might get some sharing. And I'll give you an example of that later on. So you do need, even in our viral world, to spend money on media. And there's a rule for that, the share of voice rule. We've known about this for a very long time. We know that if you're a brand with a given level of market share, then if you set your share of voice roughly equal to your share of market, your brand will be roughly stable, all other things being equal. If you're brave and you set your share of voice above your share of market, then all other things being equal, you can expect to grow over the next 2 years or so. And if you're an idiot and you set your share of voice below your share of market, perhaps because your CFO is cutting your budgets, well, you might as well look for another job, because in the next couple of years, you will be on a downward slope. Share of market will fall. We also know that there's a formula for the relationship, that the relationship between the rate of growth and share of voice is proportional to the difference between share of voice and share of market. Now, we have been expecting that rule, it's fair to say, to change, because the media landscape is changing and has changed a lot over the last 20 years. What we find actually quite surprising is there's no statistically significant change in the relationship between growth and share of voice so far. The share of voice rule is holding up remarkably well. So at least for the moment, the rules have not changed here. But what we do find is that the rules are different for different brands in different contexts. And there'll be stuff on this in the new book. We find basically that when activation is easy, then you can get away with a little bit less share of voice. So, for example, brand, where it's a high involvement purchase, where it's a very emotional decision, where there's an online link between the consumer and the brand, either through online research or online purchase, or some other direct link, like a brand that works on a subscription model. In all these cases, activation is easier. And as a result, the effects of share of voice are magnified and you can get away with a slightly lower budget. It's also true, for example, for brands that have a price advantage. You know, if you're selling cheaply, actually, it's actually a little bit easier to get growth than it would be otherwise. And so you can actually, for low-price brands, have a slightly lower share of voice. Conversely, premium brands need to up their share of voice a bit. So in the new book, there will be a table which will enable you to look at your brand's context and the various different factors affecting your brand and modify the share of voice rule to fit your brand. The fifth rule is about media. And we've said that you need brand building and you need activation and you need balance and you need different media to do those jobs, or at least different media have different strengths. Let me explain. Sales activation is, I think, the area of marketing that most people kind of get intuitively. It feels like classic marketing. So tightly target on the people who are most likely to respond to your activity. In the case of activation, that's people who are close to the point of purchase, who are very nearly about to tip over into buying your product. You might identify them through conventional research by, for example, saying, okay, people who are about to go into the shop might buy McCain's potatoes, as in Peter's example. Or you might use digital trails to say, okay, well, this person has just been Googling something to do with digital cameras. I think he's in the market for a digital camera. I'll hit him with some programmatic stuff, giving him an offer or something. And we do find, as Peter says, that for that activation job, that being informative, giving people relevant messages, relevant in the kind of traditional logical sense, is really important. Actually, you don't need to entertain people or amuse people or seduce people at this stage. With activation, what you need to do is to be of service, to help people to find the information that they need from, you know, can I get my golf clubs in the boot of this car, to where is the dealership, to how do I book a test drive, to how much is it going to cost me. Rational messages work well here. And then make your communications useful and responsive and interactive. Make it easy for people to get from their goals to their destination. That could mean providing a response mechanism, or it could mean providing them a map that shows them how to get to the shop. A favorite example of mine that I quoted yesterday, I came out of the tube station at Leicester Square in London, and I was feeling hungry, and I saw a little sign saying McDonald's 250 meters left. That was the behavioral prompt I needed to turn left to go and get a Big Mac at the right time in the right place. So that's classic marketing. I think anyone can kind of get that. Brand building is different. Brand building, remember, brand building, you are talking to people maybe 2 to 3 years before the point of sale. Some people who see brand building activity will buy now, but some of them won't act on what they see for another 2 or 3 years. That's a very broad target. Talk to anyone who might buy the category in the next 2 or 3 years. Now, if you're going to influence those people, then what you've got to do has got to be memorable. You've got to do stuff that they'll still be remembering at some level, maybe not necessarily consciously, but at some level in 2 or 3 years' time. And people do not remember facts over that length of time, particularly not facts about brands. They screen most of that stuff out right at the beginning when you start talking about in the Garnier ad, talking about the ingredients and the science. That stuff gets screened out for most people. What people do remember is how they feel about things. You must all know the feeling of you read a great book or you see a great film, and then a month or so later you try to explain to someone what it was you liked, and you go, I can't actually remember the plot, but oh my God, you know, it's such a fantastic book. You remember how you felt. Emotional memories last much, much longer than factual memories. And emotions color our decision-making in ways that we maybe don't entirely understand, but psychologists are now beginning to interrogate. So emotions are the key to brand building. So these two kinds of marketing work in quite opposite directions, if you like. And they require different approaches to media. Remember, for brand building, reach is really, really important. So you need to understand how many people you will hit with your media. Now, unfortunately, I don't have any Swedish data. I don't think precisely comparable data exists for Sweden. We're very lucky in the UK that we have this survey called the IPA Touchpoint Survey, which is a mobile panel which polls people every 30 minutes randomly to see what media they're interacting with, what brands they've just seen, what they're doing. And it gives you a like-for-like reading on the reach and dwell time and usage of different media. I like this data. It's available for the UK and for the US. I like it because it really gives you a common currency for evaluating different media. What you see here is that the big broad reach media are, by and large, still the traditional media. We're talking about TV, we're talking about outdoor, we're talking about radio. And yes, the online stuff is in there, you know, email is good, social networking is good, news brands are important. What we in the advertising world seem to think is that everybody is watching Netflix, that's down here, or online video in things like YouTube and Facebook. They are still, they're important, they're growing, but they are still relatively small in terms of their reach. So if you want big, broad reach, you need to have big, broad reach media, and that means you do still need to have the traditional media as a big part of your diet. Things are changing. What we see is that, for example, TV viewing, broadcast TV viewing is going down. Total video consumption is going up as these online video channels, the ones down here, are growing. So what we're finding is people are watching more video in more places on more devices. But I think actually the bigger story is that the change in the reach of the traditional media has been far less than most people would think. So if you want those hundreds and millions of eyeballs, then you still need to have the offline media as part of the mix. Different media have different strengths. So this chart shows the likelihood of getting strong activation effects versus the likelihood of getting strong brand effects. And typically, there's a kind of inverse relationship between them. So media down here that are very good at brand building tend to be slightly weaker at activation. Media up here that are good at activation tend to be slightly weaker at brand building. So it's a bit of a horses for courses thing. You know, some media are good at brand building, some are good at activation, and some are a bit of both. What we find is that, in general, the more rational, information, text-based sort of media tend to be better at activation. We find that the emotive audio-visual media tend to be better at brand building. But one can use different media in different ways. So, for example, TV is an example of a medium where you can use it for emotional brand building, or you can do DRTV and do it in a more rational way. So it's not a hard and fast rule. And what you will see is, for example, newspapers are pretty much in the middle as being having kind of a role for doing both brand building and activation. So you can use newspapers and you can use magazines and other print media in both ways, depending on how you flex it. As I say, offline media, traditional media, still have a very big role to play and tend to produce the biggest results. So they tend to be the most effective media. But online media tend to be highly efficient. Well, it is important to distinguish between effectiveness and efficiency. Clever marketers use both together. So, for example, video, in the world of video, TV produces much bigger effects than online video, simply because you get more viewers. But online video can be very cheap and therefore highly efficient. The killer combination is online and offline together. Online and offline work in synergy. Each makes the other work harder. What we find is that digital media, particularly digital activation, makes traditional media work better. And as a result, we find that all the main traditional offline media have become more effective over time. People say that TV is dying. That's not true. TV advertising is more effective now than it used to be. Press is more effective than it used to be. Radio is more effective than it used to be. Outdoor is more effective than it used to be, particularly since digital outdoor arrived. So everything is working better than it used to be. This should be the golden age of marketing. And I think the tech firms are learning this lesson. What we see is if you look at how Google and Amazon and Facebook and Uber and brands like that spend their marketing budgets, increasingly they're putting money into offline media. You know, we see Uber in the UK recently spending money on cinema, radio, posters, press. When Facebook launched their new Facebook Live feature in London, they used poster ads on bus shelters. Facebook presumably knows something about how advertising works. They thought posters was a better medium than Facebook advertising. So online and offline together, that's the way forward. I would be wrong to speak at an event like this without mentioning John Lewis. I work for the agency that produces the John Lewis adverts in London, and I think this is what contemporary marketing looks like at its best. John Lewis is a UK department store, and every Christmas they run a big blockbuster campaign, which is about the joy of giving Christmas presents. So let me show you an ad. So every year we do one of these kind of ads, a big blockbuster film about the emotions of giving someone a fantastic present. And we start at 7:30 in the morning on the first day of the campaign by putting it out online. So we start with a little bit of paid online video. And as you see, for example, that's the 2015 ad you saw there. Got 9 million views straight away online. That is a small effect. What happened then was people then start sharing the ad. People rush to be the first person to see that ad. That gives you a much bigger effect. So we're talking about 35 to 40 million views once you've got the organic sharing in. But actually, that's not the real story. What happens then is, later in the evening, it goes on TV. Now we're talking about half a billion views during the course of the campaign with branded TV. That's what a real marketing effect looks like. Those are the kinds of numbers you need. If someone talks to you about they got 1 million views for their campaign, ignore them. We are talking about you need billions of views over the course of a few years. So that's the brand TV. The clever thing is, this created such a movement in the UK that everybody wanted to be part of it. So for that campaign, the charity Age UK made their own ad off the back of it, showing the man on the moon being isolated and highlighting the problem of loneliness amongst old people in the UK. And then what we got was people like Sony and Canon and makers of the products that are sold in John Lewis making their own ads, which then featured, for example, a Sony camera floating across the lunar landscape attached to the balloons. And that gave us enough to take us up to about the 1 billion exposures, just under 1 billion exposures for that campaign. That's what a real marketing campaign looks like. That's what marketing looks like when you've got online and offline working in synergy. And that's not even the full story, because that's just the Christmas campaign. The Christmas campaign lights up the 6 weeks in the run-up to Christmas, but 365 days a year, they are doing ads for products, for kettles and fridges. They are doing ads for new store openings. They are doing ads for sales, all the kind of activation stuff, which taps into the emotions of the brand stuff, but is doing the hard-working job every day of the year, literally every day of the year. And as you'll see, a big part of that is print. Print still plays a very big role within John Lewis's armory for the activation part of the job. And there's some examples. So press and print still plays a really important role, both for activation and for brand. And Peter's going to talk a bit more about that.
Okay, thanks, Liz. So very good. We're keeping the audience. No one's run away just yet. This is a bit
couple
of a marathon.
Are asleep, I
it's
think.
A bit of a marathon. So look, I think what the fantastic campaign Les has just shown you, particularly the print stuff at the back end, has shown you that one of the strengths that we see in print, and you saw it on that scatter chart with the negative correlation between brand building and activation, that print is one of those relatively rare media that can kind of swing both ways. I don't want to torture that analogy for the moment, but so it can play in the brand building camp quite nicely. And some of those kind of activation ads that Les just showed you for Jonas are actually terribly brand literate as well. I love the lipstick one, for instance. If that doesn't say to us everything we need to know about John Lewis and its take on, you know, luxury and pleasure and all the rest of it, then I don't know what would. So they work very well across the brand and activation divide. And I think that is part of the story that that press has to say. But it's actually a bit more nuanced than that, so I'm just going to pull a few strands together for you. So what we found, this is just a time trend. You can see, actually, that press effectiveness has turned the corner. There was a period, and this is six-year rolling data, so it gives you a kind of slightly lagged view of where perhaps press effectiveness seemed to bottom out. There was a period when press was losing circulation and appeared to be losing effectiveness. And I think a lot of people wrote press off on the back of that. But at the national press level, and I just want to make this clear, it's about more of an observation on national newsprint particularly, but magazines as well. The corner was turned really when they started to get their digital act together and started introducing digital editions and using all of the benefits that that gives you, not just in terms of reach and additional viewing and circulation, but also the ability to do interesting stuff with the ads that feature on it. So we've seen a really strong reversal of press effectiveness, and is now growing very, very strongly, particularly as you can see in the most recent years on that chart. Now, local press, interestingly, we can't trend it in that way because we're only able to break out local press in more recent years, since 2012. This database didn't record how the press was split up prior to that period. So I can't give you a trend on it, but quite clearly, local press has more or less been marching in step, but for different reasons, really, than all press. Yes, there is availability online for a lot of local press issues, local press titles, but it's by no means as well developed as it is for national press, so I don't think we can put it down to that. There are other factors at play in the very healthy report card that really local press sustains. So you can see here that the uplifts, so this measures simply the uplifts that you observe in campaigns that did or did not use each of those two different media channels. And there is not a total overlap, there's quite a significant number of cases that use one or the other but not both. So you can't put it all down to the effect of national press. All press has in fact slightly outperformed local press, but by not by a large margin. So local press is also doing something equally as powerful as national press as well. But here's the interesting thing, and I'm making this observation now really about national press, because we're going to come and see what the picture is for local press in a moment. What we have noticed very clearly from this chart is that press as an advertising medium appears to have lost its activation role. Now, this is really for two reasons, partly because it's not used in that way anymore. All the money, the activation money, has been sucked out of press, really, by and large, national press anyway, and put into particularly digital media, sometimes into digital titles of press, but usually into digital media. So it's partly that, but of course also digital media do activation very powerfully and very strongly, and it's very easy to measure and all those usual things. So we can see that press overall appears to have lost its activation role. But as we're going to see, that is not true of local press. But we have to be very careful about judging press on the basis of short-term effects, particularly when it's national press. So if you judge print in the short term, you look at short-term case studies and their ability to drive short-term activation effects, that's the left hand of those two charts, you see that those campaigns that used print underperformed those that didn't. So you might form the point of view that actually print is not really a very powerful medium in the current era. But you know that's wrong because I've shown you the data. If we use long-term case studies and we use a long-term metric, such as our business effects metric, you see completely the opposite. You see that those case studies that did make powerful use of print were significantly more effective than those that used very little print or none. And the more they use, the more that effect is. I'm not showing you the data here. We've done work for news brands in the UK, and it shows that the more powerful the use is of that medium, the more powerful the effect is. So print is still delivering something immensely valuable to advertisers, particularly now, I think, in this era of kind of fake news and the increasing concern consumers have over the kinds of content and material that is served to them digitally. There is still something very powerful about seeing something in print. We know it, we can trust it, because the people that printed it will go to jail if it is false. As simple as that. They will be held to account in a way that we know the big digital media barons simply will never be held to account. So we trust what we see printed. And I think this is an immensely important issue in the continued buoyancy of print as an advertising medium. But let's just come back to this issue of activation roles, because I said to you earlier all that all press seems to have lost its potency in that era, in that area, partly because of how it's used. Local press retains a really powerful role as an activation medium. Local press still seems to have a powerful role in local communities and with local people, and it's a great way of getting us to local stores and telling us about local stores. And I'm going to give you three examples in just a second of case studies in the IPA data, recent case studies that used local press in various and interesting ways. But the thing that unites them all, I think, is that they weren't just trying to activate. They were using this magic of local press, particularly, but press in general, to not just drive short-term effects, but also to contribute to the brand-building task and to exploit the trust in printed media to help do that. But before I do that, I just want to make the point, a lot of people say, yeah, but come on, this local press stuff, you know, surely the way we should all be going is what some people would refer to as one-to-one at scale. You know, what we're doing is we're serving tightly targeted messages to consumers based on their digital trail, what we know about them as individuals. We're going to do that at scale, so we're going to cover the nation with these kind of one-to-one messages. We're going to do a lot of tight targeting, a lot of segmentation, and surely that has to be a better way than using this sort of messy world of local press. Well, let's just test drive that way of thinking for a moment, because we've got a big slug of case studies in the IPA database in recent years. It's something like a quarter of them in the last two rounds of the Effectiveness Awards that have done precisely that. They've put significant amounts of the budget into one-to-one at scale, essentially using big data to serve personalized, real-time messages to consumers based on what that digital trail told the advertisers about consumers. And we're going to test drive that in terms of short and long-term effects and see if it can deliver in the same way that local press does across the short-term and long-term divide. Can one-to-one at scale deliver activation with brand building, which is the holy grail? It's what we want to do. If we can do it in one medium, it's got to be a good medium. It doesn't mean we have to do it in one medium, but it is a powerful point in favour of one medium if we can do both together. So one-to-one at scale, if you like, undoubtedly is a powerful way of driving short-term activation. There's no doubt about that. It's much more powerful than the old-fashioned model that Les was talking about earlier on, about serving our message to existing customers, loyalty marketing, where we just try and nudge them into buying again. This way, we can more or less double our effectiveness in terms of driving short-term. There's no doubt about that. The problem with one-to-one at scale is it's not a great way to build a brand. Serving tailored messages one-to-one to people doesn't build these shared, popular, widely seen and overseen brand associations that print and broadcast media in general do. So it is actually a lousy brand building medium, not a good way to drive long-term effects. So these case studies that we're looking at here that pulled significant amounts of money out of brand building into this one-to-one at scale kind of initiative sacrifice long-term growth in order to feed that short-term obsession. Now, arguably, if they had put some of that money into local press, assuming it was relevant to the task at hand, they might have avoided some of that long-term loss, because local press can do two of these tasks at once. So let me just give you, I'm going to give you some answers, but sorry, just to finalise that, this is not a mistake any of us need to make anymore. We have no excuses for making this mistake and putting all our money into one-to-one at scale, because our friends at Procter & Gamble have done the experiment for us with hundreds of millions of dollars, and they've been very public about the financial disaster that ensued. We all know. So Mark Pritchard, quoted in the Wall Street Journal, said, "We targeted too much and we went too narrow." And usefully, he went on to say, the bigger your brand, the more you need broad reach and less targeted media. And that's the way they are now going as a result of that. It's no way to drive long-term growth. They did the experiment for us. There's an final benefit in favour of local press, which is these strong multiplier effects. Now, to be fair, we see multiplier effects with most channels. It's an observation Les and I made more than 10 years ago, that case studies that use more channels tend to be more effective than case studies that use fewer channels, because you get these multipliers. Seeing the message in many different contexts and environments tends to amplify its effectiveness. But these are big multiplier effects, even by the standards that we're used to observing in this database. So local press used alongside TV has a particularly powerful effect, and that's partly because of the case studies that are using this. Often they're retailers who know very well that they need to be doing a big, powerful brand initiative on TV. Aldi and Lidl, good examples of this. But you know what? We need to remind people at the time of purchase. We use local press to remind them of that message, but also to steer them towards whatever our deals and offers are at the time doing the activation role. And it also has a very powerful effect alongside social media. It's true to say that most media have powerful multiplier effects alongside social media, but that's more to do with the relative inadequacies of social media than it is to do with the strengths of the media in question. But those, you know, if you take the two most celebrated and talked about media at the moment, TV and social media, local press is a useful running mate, if you like, in their particular approach. Okay, so let me just give you those three quick case studies. Apologies for the quality of the visuals. Clearly, the case study authors didn't think that their local press efforts were their big showcase, so they often put rather poor quality images. But I'm actually very interested in how they used local press. As I say, all these three case studies used it not just as an activation medium, but also as a brand-building medium, and the effects kind of speak for themselves. So let's take Lidl UK, and apologies for this. These guys They put about 10% of their budget into local press, quite significant. But Lidl are on a big fight back against, particularly against Aldi in the UK. So Aldi learnt the power of brand building around about 4 or 5 years ago in the UK, shortly after the global financial crisis. And they had a very celebrated and immensely successful campaign that built the sense that Aldi products, Aldi brands, were just as good as the brand leader, but a whole lot cheaper. So they did a big brand building job on quality. Lidl were left in their wake. Lidl was losing out massively to Aldi. Their growth was strongly lagging Aldi. But also, Lidl have actually a price premium they have to deal with. Lidl, on average, is about 6% more expensive in the UK than Aldi is across a basket of comparable goods. Not something they want to crow about, but it's in the case study. So they really needed to address this, because just slugging it out with prices against Aldi was never going to win. So they developed a campaign. It has TV. It's a classic multi-channel campaign. But you can see them reiterating the kind of quality message. They go back to the provenance of many of their products. They talk about how they source them and why and how they are good. And they also talk about prices. So even with a 6% price premium over Aldi, these guys outgrew them by 10% from the moment this campaign started. Outgrew Aldi by 10% with a 6% price premium. Now, we haven't showed you the chart, but you only do that with brand building. The only way to build, to improve price elasticity, to reduce price elasticity, is through brand building. You simply won't achieve it through activation. One-to-one at scale will not solve that particular problem. You can only do that if you're building, you know, as I say, good and powerful associations, in this case, quality. Here's a brand that will be dear to all of your hearts. So this is a lovely little idea, a regional idea. It ran in Perth and Adelaide in Australia. Their problem was trying to get people to keep the IKEA catalogue so that they would continue to work in their homes over longer periods of time. Didn't go straight in the bin. So they thought, well, why don't we pay people a rent? You know, the whole thing about IKEA is we're great about maximising efficient use of space. That's what we're brilliant at. So let's give them away, let's pay them a rent to keep the catalogue. And there was a kind of very clever way that you could redeem this rent in store later on. Lovely. But it also, it had to have that quirky Swedish kind of sense of humour that we all love and associate IKEA with. So we have these kinds of ads that says, you know, quiet bookish type requires a little room to rent, and so on. Lots of lovely classic IKEA humour that we love. So they had to do both jobs. This is fantastically successful. In the two cities where they ran this campaign, they drove footfall up by 10% compared to other cities, where obviously the product offering was otherwise the same. And indeed, footfall is only the start of the story. Sales rose by even more than that. So it's another nice example of how the use of local press, which they had to use, this was an initiative in two cities, how it can really deliver growth. And if you don't believe me, you believe your own most famous Swedish brand, these guys know it works for them. Okay. And my final example, so this is kind of London, this is a London campaign, there's a bit of London humour in here. So this is for Six to rent a car. What they wanted to do was to drive growth in the London region, and they wanted to associate it with kind of prestige. You get a better car for your money if you rent from Sixt than some of their competitors. So it was in a London-only campaign. They used local press. They used local posters. So here is classic, you know, London humour. Rent a car you'll want your ex to see you in. This car says Playboy. The price says T-Boy. And then my own personal favourite, which is this takeover of the local London mag, which says, take your smug grin and stick it where the sun shines. Okay. This is all classic, you know, London humour. It's rather more crude than Swedish humour. You know, care is much more subtle and much nicer. But again, you know, they put about 25% of their budget, 25% of their budget into the press side of this. A lot of posters as well and some radio as well. So all of these cases, IKEA was 30% of their budget. Into just the press side of it. There were other media as well, posters and so forth, that were local media. They're all big, big spenders on local press. And these guys, again, drove a very impressive sales uplift. Return on investment of this campaign was something like 80%. Every pound they spent on it generated net of costs about 80 pence in incremental profit, which for a low-budget local initiative in a very expensive city to advertise in is a pretty impressive result. So hopefully we've convinced you that press is a good medium to consider, carry on thinking about, and that it is a useful part of this general observation we have that generally meeting the rules that we've observed, reach, balancing brand building and activation, and so on and so forth. All the rules, those five rules we've identified to you, are all relevant to the world of press and local press as well. But I just want to give you our warning point. What happens if we ignore those rules? So very quickly, we know what happens when you ignore these rules because lots of people are ignoring these rules. You know, Les and I bang on about the dangers of short-termism to rooms of lots of people who sit there and nod, and then they go back to their offices and they do short-term advertising. So they just ignore us, basically. So don't for a moment think that fame has worked for us as a strategy. So we know this because we can see this in our data, enormous explosion of short-term. This is the percentage of the case studies that were designed to work over periods of less than 6 months. Driven very much by online brands, of course, very much more subject and seduced by the whole digital mantra that is all about, you know, short-term effects and short-term metrics. It's also driven even more powerfully by those case studies, those brands that enjoy very high levels of online research, whether they're insurance or financial services brands or whatever. Those have really driven the short-term shift in thinking. And we're going to come back and look at how that move to short-termism plays out in terms of effectiveness patterns in my final slide in this area of the presentation. The problem with short-term is if we're looking to drive short-term effects, of course we end up doing a lot more activation. So this simply records the proportion of the budget that was allocated to brand building. We've said 60-40 as a typical norm, should be a 60 in both those piles. For short-term campaigns, it drops well below 60 and is falling fast. Even the long-term campaigns that should know better, even they are underspending. And we said the trend was the other way. It should be towards spending more of our budget on brand building, not less. Even the long-term campaigns are going in the wrong direction. So short-termism is a really corrosive, dangerous force. We have to resist. We have to stop the idea that brand marketing was last millennium's thinking and short-term digital activation is this millennium's thinking. Because it's going to kill brands, and if it kills brands, it will kill businesses, and it's starting to happen. We know it's happening. It's also being driven by an obsession with ROI. Some of you may have seen us talk about this chart before. Let's just look at what happens if we're obsessed with ROI. So we're going to look at what drives profit. And you can see here, this is the correlations of each of these metrics with the profit metric. You can see here that all the usual suspects, sales, market share, penetration, pricing, loyalty, all correlate reasonably strongly with profit growth. As you would expect, they're important business metrics. The basket of them all correlates really strongly with profit growth, which is why we use it as a metric. Notice that the number of brand effects, the extent to which we strengthen our brand, also correlates very strongly and significantly with profit growth. So if we're not strengthening our brand, we massively reduce our chances of generating profit growth. Key piece of learning. Wake up, guys in digital. But just notice at the bottom of this list, our ability to drive activation effects does correlate, of course, but at a much lower level. And ROI, the ROI we generate, is also at the bottom of the pile and at a lower level of significance. Now, that says to us that ROI is not a great metric for predicting profit growth, but it doesn't say it's a dangerous one. The dangerous bit comes here, which is what happens if we chase ROI, if we make decisions about media choices, creative work, creative routes, if we make it on the basis of short-term, particularly short-term ROI metrics, it could not be more dangerous. The only thing that will influence us is the ability of that media or creative choice to drive short-term effects. The only thing that correlates strongly and highly significantly with ROI. This is what happens. It teaches us to go for the low-hanging fruit in the market. That's all we're going to do. Just activate the hell out of probably people who already know us or already bought us. We will not bother with the brand building piece. And worse, so all these metrics that we know are so important to long-term growth do not even correlate at any level of significance with ROI. We're not going to bother with them. We're going to forget brand building. Of course, this is what's happening on a huge scale. But worst of all, the very metric that Byron Sharp teaches us is the most important one for driving long-term growth, our ability to get new consumers in and drive penetration. If anything, negatively correlates with ROI, because it's the very opposite of reaching for low-hanging fruit. We've got to speak to people who don't know us, probably don't like us, certainly don't think about us. It's tough and it takes time. Don't do it if you're chasing ROI. But if you're chasing ROI, I advise you to have your next job lined up pretty sharpish, right? Because it's going to end you in disastrous situations. This is what we're learning. A lovely quote from Paul Polman. He's a Dutchman. He knows about saving money. Pardon, my apologies to any of you in the audience who are Dutch. The Dutch are always the first to admit that they're very focused on a deal and an offer. You simply cannot save your way to prosperity. And he was making a broader point about the need to invest if you want to grow. It's absolutely true of marketing. But that's what ROI drives us to. ROI leads us to spend minimal amounts of money doing incredibly ineffective amounts of advertising. And so long as we're spending tiny amounts of money, that relatively marginal effect we'll achieve will generate a good ROI. It's a ratio of what we get back to what we put in. And the easiest way to maximize a ratio is to minimize the spend. It's happening. I mean, I'm not giving you a piece of theory. This is happening on an industrial scale around the world with a lot of very responsible marketers and business people who think that chasing ROI is a fantastically sensible thing to do. Suicidal. We know this happening. This is the UK split. Advertising budget in 2000 was about 60-40. Advertising budget in 2016 is about 50-50. That's billions of pounds. It's happening on a global scale. It's being pulled out of brand building in order to feed this obsession with short-term sales activation. And our own IPA data absolutely echoes this. This is an enormous study done by Enders, and it looks at the entire expenditure of the UK in the UK marketplace. And this is how it's playing out. So the blue line is how short-termism has exploded over the years amongst all the case studies. And just notice it's a kind of mirror image, really, of what's happened in terms of effectiveness. For a period of time, short-termism was stable and low. And as the economies and the synergies of online and offline grew, and we were learning how to use new digital tools more and more, we got a nice growing trend in terms of effectiveness. But since short-termism took off, and we started things getting out of balance, we've seen a massive reversal of that, and we're more or less back to where we were at the turn of the millennium. It could not be more dangerous and damaging, and the trend is clearly strongly downhill. Efficiency fell. I mean, initially, we were doing good things. We were driving efficiency, but the very objective we have of improving ROI, making our campaigns ever more efficient, we're even throwing that away now. Because as I showed you earlier on, if we don't strengthen our brands, we cannot activate them very well. And we're getting to the point now where the brands that we're trying to drive short-term effects off are weakening to the point where even the efficiencies we get from powerful activation are faltering. These are dangerous times in marketing. Very dangerous times. And it's, of course, driving a massive withdrawal of investment into long-term brand-building campaigns. Now, we don't think budgets have really fallen by that amount. What's happened is a lot of the money that was driving, if you like, above-the-line brand-building is being sucked away into invisible expenditure, particularly on, shall we say, trade, promotions and discounts, but also paid search. I'm working with businesses where 75% of their budget is spent on paid search. That is insane, totally insane. That is what's happening. The money is disappearing off the radar, and it is a big part of the problem. It seemed to be hardworking. Now, I said I would just review how this plays out across different sectors. It's not the same that all sectors have pursued this lemming-like approach to the precipice in the same way. We can see that the guys who are doing it, who are really teaching us how to screw things up, are the financial service sector. My apologies to any of you who are in financial services, and I hope you're not one of these. But they are the ones that have espoused short-termism most powerfully in the most recent period versus the period immediately prior to the global financial crisis. And they're the ones that have seen the biggest loss, astonishing loss in terms of typical levels of effectiveness. The retail guys learnt this problem many years ago. And they, of course, have been driven in part towards short terms, and they can't avoid that, but they know how to handle this issue. And above all, if you look particularly at Aldi and Lidl, the two German discounters, they know and have evidenced to all of us that brand building is really important in retail, as has John Lewis, of course. So what do? We're in the shit. Lots of businesses are in the shit. You are possibly in the shit. How do we get out of it? Les has got a fantastic case study that I really hope you will all learn from. Socket
yep. Terms. So I've been working with the AA, the automobile, not the Alcoholics Anonymous. although it's quite convenient when I tell my wife I'm going to an AA meeting. I mean the Automobile Association. So And this organisation, about 100 years old, historically very strong brand in the UK, but they got themselves into a bit of trouble. A few years back, they cut all their brand activity in favour of what they would call hard-working activation. Cut all the press, cut all the TV, cut all the posters. They just did DM, outbound emails and offers and so forth. Used discounts to drive people into their website to join up to the AA. And then once they got them in, then they milked them for, you know, each year by putting up the price sneakily. And this was really profitable. They didn't spend very much money. ROIs were high. The returns that they were getting were supposedly really good. And then they did a bit of analysis. And here's what they discovered. They found that all their brand metrics were in free fall. They'd reached the point where this 100-year-old, very famous organization now had about 6% of the population had never even heard of them. The whole category was becoming commoditized. People were no longer searching for the AA. They were using generic search terms like breakdown cover and roadside recovery and emergency cover. And that meant that they were going to price comparison sites, not to the AA website. And that meant a spiral down in prices, a price war with their two main rivals, bigger and bigger discounts being required each year. Meanwhile, their existing customers were getting really pissed off at the fact that they were being ripped off every year with price rises. So churn was rising, market share was falling. And they did a little projection of where they would be in 5 years' time, and they realized, fantastic ROI now, bankruptcy in 5 years' time. So they took the brave decision to reallocate their budgets and to rebudget. They moved there. They read a book by some guys called Binet and Field. And they moved their share of voice back in line with their market share and above their market share. They reallocated 60-40, and they did this. Can you turn the sound up? And that turned their market share decline round in a year. All the brand metrics started going back up. All the search terms, people started searching for the AA again, not roadside recovery. They got more people coming in. They improved retention. Everything turned around, even though they were offering less in the way of discounts. It's not rocket science. You need to do a bit of brand building. You need a nice bit of creative. You need something that people enjoy watching, preferably with a good tune, and you need to make sure everyone sees it. The rules haven't changed that much.
Okay, so just before we take questions, which is a nudge to all of you to start thinking or plucking up the courage to ask questions, let me just end with a quick conclusion. I think you kind of know where we're coming from. You know our rant, so I'll be brief. We've absolutely got to restore the right balance between long and short-term objectives. We've got to stop chasing short-term effects all the time. Or we are going to suffer massively. And we've given you the evidence, I hope, to persuade you that this is already happening. It's not a hypothesis, it's not theory, it's a real and present danger. It's happening right now, right here. It's happening in Sweden, I'm sure, every bit as much as it's happening in the UK. We all make the same mistakes. Let's stop making those mistakes. Get back to balance. That means effectively getting the brand activation balance, right? Getting back to let's not be too obsessed with 60-40, because as we've identified to you, it varies some context, but let's work out what our ideal sweet spot should be. We're going to give you the tools to do that in a few weeks' time. And once you've done that, let's pursue that, and if needs be, adjust from that. But get back to a balance between brand and activation. Part of doing that means we've got to keep on reaching broadly, and building broad mental availability. Those are the two most important kind of rules, if you like, for execution: reach and mental availability in terms of what our campaigns deliver. Otherwise, long-term success, I promise you, will elude you. We've also got to get back to investing in share of voice for growth. Stop kidding ourselves that we can defy the laws of gravity and fly without any power behind us. So we need to spend, and that law is alive and well and not going anywhere. So again, let's remember that. And then last, but by no means least, a lot of the subtlety of this is about casting media that are appropriate for the job. Programmatic isn't going to do this for us. It's just an algo. It's brainless. Right, most of the people who devise these things. This is about understanding what the job that brand is trying to do and casting the media appropriately for it. And not all media are able to do both brand and activation with equal power. We've argued that audiovisual is powerful for brand building, but press has its own strengths in terms of authority and trust that are worth exploiting. Press generally has a unique ability to span the divide. So again, let's think more creatively about how we use press and remember that it can do both jobs. That's enough ranting from us. Thank you very much for listening. I think we're going to try and take some questions.
One more bit of activation.
Oh, sorry.
We've done the brand building, so now the activation. We have a new book out in a couple of weeks, which has all those rules in. And then also there's another book out right now by a guy called Les Binet and Sarah Carter, which takes a slightly different approach. It's about ineffectiveness, and it's based on 31 years of fuck-ups.
Okay. I tried to spare you the activation, but he leapt in. I'm really sorry.
So if you want a read with fewer graphs, then go for that one. Thank you.
Great. Thanks.
So please stay up.
We will. Promise.
So thank you, Les and Peter, for a very interesting presentation. So we're going over to the Q&A.
Okay.
And we've had a lot of interesting questions. Thanks for this. We won't be able to have them all, but a few highlights.
Okay.
I have some easy ones, please.
Through on the machine, then.
We picked out the easy ones, right, Emily?
Yes, we did.
Okay, so we thought we'd start with, I would like to assure you that it's the same thing in Sweden and in Scandinavia.
I bet.
The balance is wrong. What we see at many of our clients, many large marketing departments, is that the balance is wrong, but what is happening is that they are quickly redefining what is brand and what is activation.
Yeah.
So the balance is wrong, and now suddenly all the guys that did the sales activation, they are saying, no, we are doing branding.
Mm-hmm.
So all the CRM guys are doing branding, and all the social media guys are doing branding, and all the digital guys are doing branding. So suddenly the balance is right again.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. So which brings us to the first question, addressing where you started a little. The definition of sales activation and brand building. And we had a detailed question here that was, it was funny because I was really about to start here, and the question was, in these data bank cases that you're referring to, how is it
defined?
Okay. In BB and SA? And then, additional question after that is, if a certain campaign aims to do both,
the way that you define brand building is really in terms of what you're trying to achieve, the purpose. And so with brand building, what you're trying to do is you're trying to plant something in people's heads that will last, You're trying to create an enduring preference for a brand based on memory structures which might be conscious or unconscious. Activation is about getting an immediate or a fairly immediate response and doesn't require long-term memories. So brand building is defined in terms of what you're trying to achieve, and that's how it's done within the data bank.
So we have a basket of metrics. There's about 7 or 8 of them that explore whether the campaign is trying to change the way people think about the brand and feel about this. So there are lots of metrics that relate to what we would call brand building: awareness, trust, you know, kind of emotional engagement. There's a basket of those. But there's one metric in particular, but there are others that we have occasionally looked at, but they don't add anything to it. There's one particular metric was the campaign trying to drive short-term effects? Mm. And we can measure that as an objective and as an outcome as well. So we use that basket of metrics, but they are objectives, and we can examine whether they were primary or secondary, whether they were both there, whether brand building as well as short-term activation were both there, or whether it was just one or the other.
We've
got lots of new metrics as well around the activation space.
In the last few years, we've added a question into the questionnaire about what percentage of your budget was allocated to short-term activation versus brand building.
Yeah.
In the early days, we had to kind of use things like media usage as a proxy for it. But I think that's the core of it, is it's about what you're trying to do to people's heads versus their behaviour.
So on that point, we know now with forensic accuracy what the balance was. So each channel, every author is asked, was that used for brand building or activation, or perhaps both? And you can then compile, by looking at their entire channel usage, what the balance was in the campaign. And it's very revealing when you do that.
Yeah.
So we know it's a pretty accurate way of measuring it now. We're pretty happy with how it's done. But in the past, it's been a bit clunky.
Great. Thank you. Emily?
Thank you. Second question we received was, is it any brand in the study that drives knowledge campaign instead of sales activations on a short-term basis? Like Tesla, maybe you won't do short-term sales campaigns, but they maybe need to build knowledge based on campaign of why you should switch to an electric car and have those campaigns always on, since people always will have questions regarding gas car versus electric cars, at least until the norm has switched.
Quite a long question.
Quite a long question, yes.
This is what happens when you get people to write questions. I would argue there are some campaigns in the database where it's for a charity or like government information campaigns. So we tend to look at those separately. So there's a little bit in the new book where we look at not-for-profit businesses. So arguably, a government department might have a duty to put certain kinds of information out there just to be of service to the public, like, say, the government statistics department or something like that. But when Tesla is doing a campaign to inform people of the benefit of electric cars, they're not doing it out of charity. They're doing it because they want to sell cars. And so the metric that matters is ultimately how many cars they sell in the long term. So it should be judged in the same way.
But there are plenty of brands there for which there is an information. I gave you an example of one, which is the EasyJet case study, which is very much about selling where they go. But they don't just give you the information. They sell the sizzle, if you like, as well as the sausage, to use that old word. They make you want to go there. And this is the important thing, that if you're just conveying information, the brand effect will be much weaker. And I certainly hope, I'm not familiar with the campaigns that Tesla are running, but I suspect that they are very powerfully building their brand whilst they're doing it. Mm. Because they're saying, we own this space, and they need to be doing that because a lot of, premium car manufacturers are now on the case. So I hope they've done it strongly enough to ensure that they can withstand the branded tide of competition that's now coming their way. And we will see, did they squander the last 4 or 5 years riding the cool trip on their own of being the only significant electric car manufacturer in the world? If they squandered it, they will die. And if they didn't, they'll survive. And actually, I hope they will. I hope they will survive, because I think they've done fantastic good for the cause. But we will see.
Thank you.
Okay, so we got several questions regarding, if you're a small brand, Okay, reach matters.
Yes.
And but I'm a small brand, and I cannot afford it. How should I think as a small brand?
Every brand can afford some reach.
Yes.
So you have to do what you can within your budget. So small brands. So for take the share of voice rule.
Yeah.
The share of voice rule says that your share of voice should be at least as big as your share of market or above. So that means that budgets for small brands will be smaller than budgets for big brands. But the point is that they punch above their weight. So the new book does show you how to flex the rules for small brands. Yeah.
So if you're a small brand, share of voice is really the way to look at your budget.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
And in fact, because right.
I mean, clearly,
bar is lower for you. You just have to match your very low share of market.
Yeah.
But the point Les has made is absolutely vital. Is that the and we will identify this. And there are scale economies that you don't enjoy as a small brand.
Yeah.
So you've really got to come up with a campaign that begins to level the playing field. So it's got to be it's got to be super effective. It's, you know, go for the fame model because that's your best bet at trying to level the playing field with larger, with the brand leader who has an inbuilt advantage. They can get away with share of voice that's lower than their share of market and still drive growth. So we have to level that playing field.
And you also need to think about why you're a small brand. So, for example, it may be that you're a local brand and that you only really operate in the local market. So be big within that market. Go for reach within that market. Go for share of voice within that market.
Mm.
But the rules are not fundamentally different. It is tough for small brands because they, particularly small brands that are not new. It's great to be a new brand because you're the new kid on the block and everyone's interested in you. And it's great to be a big brand because you get economies of scale. Small brands are caught in between. We talk in the book a little bit about what we call the small brand trap and why you really... If you're launching a new brand, you want to get as big as fast as possible to avoid that trap.
Yeah. Thank you.
Another very interesting question that we received, or actually received several ones on them. How can you be data-driven in brand building?
Okay.
Great question.
Being data-driven, let me say, I'm not anti-data. I'm an econometrician. My day job is data. My favorite days when I'm not doing this, I'm in Excel. You know, that's a good day for
me.
We're
very sad.
Yeah.
Data, don't go out on a date with either of us.
I hate that phrase being data driven. To me, it's like I hate the term real time planning. That's what I call reacting. You know, real time planning is an oxymoron, as we say in English. It's a contradiction in terms. Planning is something you do ahead to prepare. Real time is about reacting. And being data driven is being mindless and heedless and being at the mercy of whatever dial is flashing red on your screen.
You could square being data driven with brand building if you were measuring the right kind of data, if you were getting the right kinds of feedback. Now, there's a good academic, Karen Nelson Field, who's done a lot of work on some of the kinds of metrics that online video use to record their impact and fundamentally question them. She says the standards are too low. And so if you're measuring the right thing, if you're measuring the right kinds of impacts and the right kinds of responses, there's no reason why you shouldn't have some quite compelling short-term data to say, look, the long-term effects of what we have just done are likely to be good, and if we sit around and wait for 6 to 12 months, we're going to see good stuff. There's no reason why we shouldn't be able to do that. It's just we haven't done it. And there is a project going on, well, it's trying to get off the ground now, between Thinkbox in the UK, or the TV kind of industry representative, and the Ehrenberg Bass Institute, to try and identify what these leading indicators, mental availability leading indicators are, that will suggest and imply jam tomorrow, to use that expression, that we're going to make great gains tomorrow. But we've got to nail that. We've got to know what the data we should be collecting now is. And we haven't really done enough work on that because we've got too distracted by, you know, likes and shares and all that kind of...
But the problem with data being data-driven is it usually implies short-term, in my opinion. If you look at John Lewis, for example, John Lewis don't make those campaigns by somehow an algorithm that says, you know, we're going to serve you an ad with a penguin in it, and you're going to serve you an ad with a telescope in it. They think carefully about human emotions and what people are like, and they, you know, we help them to create something that is going to wow people. And they do look at the data, but they, what they do is they look at, you know, a year afterwards, how much did that sell? How much profit did we make? How did that compare to previous years? They take a very long-term view, and they do very well out of it. Every pound they spend on those campaigns generates 10 or 11 pounds of extra profit, not sales, but profit. That's by looking at the right data, the long-term data.
But I'm sure intuitively the team at your agency and at the client know whether they've got a success.
Yes,
or not.
Absolutely.
They know it intuitively, but the data lag. You know, you only get the data.
Yeah.
So we just need to do more work.
That's, again, why I hate that phrase, being data-driven, because actually understanding and empathy and intuition usually is more efficient and effective than short-term data.
Yeah. Many people that are... That think they are data-driven, they don't know actually about this data.
Yeah. great scientists, you know, the Einsteins of this world, started with intuition, and then they looked at the maths. Mm. Be like a scientist,
I think we
not
have
somebody who's watching a dial.
We have to stop saying that data is everything and intuition is no longer anything. I mean, we have to get back to understanding that we need both, really, to feed growth. We need intuition and data.
Okay, so time is running up.
It is.
Thanks a lot, Les and Peter.
You're very welcome.
We heard there was a debate in Australia recently between Mark Ritson and Byron Sharp. And it was quite funny because you will get a present here, and I will read what it says in here, because it says here from Mark Ritson, "I think in the ultimate debate between Ritson and Sharp, the winner is Field and Binet." So thanks
a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's very kind.
Thank you
very much. Aww.